Hi, you're with India Post Live. India Post Live is, of course, India's first online news conversation web TV, where you too can participate in this conversation. I'm Ishan Russell. And today at India Post Live, we're talking about the exit polls. Yes, and the exit polls are under a cloud. There have been question marks that have been raised and raised by fellow media professionals against the exit poll conducted by one particular TV channel. And the fact that the agency that was attributed with conducting that poll has said that they haven't conducted it. So what does this really mean? Because there are a lot of question marks that then it raises about the entire media, how it's handled this 2014 general election, and the whole nature of the beast as far as the exit polls are concerned. And we'll be discussing all that and more today. We have with us in the studio two very respected and senior journalists, Venkatesh Ramakrishnan, associate editor of The Hindu, and Frontline joins us in the studio. Also, Amit Sen Gupta is a senior journalist, joins us in the studio. We'll also be joined by, from Calcutta by Matthew V. He's a political researcher and analyst, has been studying the science of elections for some time now, and has been aiding various agencies often with conducting their polls. So I'll start with you, Venkatesh. What do we make of this controversy? The fact that the agency is saying we've not conducted it, but the channel went on a big held a big show yesterday, claiming that Modi was winning through their poll.
It's indeed a mystery. From what I hear, there are wheels within wheels in this whole controversy. It's not just about agency saying that we have not conducted the polls. There are so many personalities tussles, there are institutional tussles, which are all built into this whole controversy. It may be too early to say, rundown times now for this, because, they have not come up with their own clarification so far. So we'll have to actually wait for their clarification to come out. But if you look at the whole exit poll process, I mean, there are very many issues. This is only one of the issues that have come up now. There are very many issues in the way exit polls are conducted, the methodology that is adopted, the kind of tabulation that they do, the kind of mechanisms that they use to do this. So these are all varied questions which have come up as we conduct exit polls. But then this has added a new twist to the whole thing. And I think if what I am hearing is right, if the personality tussles and institutional clashes between the so-called pollster companies that are doing it, then it is certainly a sorry state of affairs.
All right, it certainly could be a sorry state of affairs. What do you think about it? Write into us. Go to indiapostlive.com, log in and post your comments over there. You can also use Twitter or Facebook to get in touch with us. Just go to our Facebook page and post a comment, or use Twitter. Use hashtag IndiaPostLive, or use our Twitter handle at IndiaPostLive to join in this conversation. If you have any questions for our experts, you're most welcome to come in and ask them, and they'll answer it right over here for you. And while you're on India Post Live, check out another prediction contest that we're running. It's called the Hum Bole Contest, where we are allowing you to predict the winner of this 2014, the big general election. And the winner, of course, gets a sedan car. Yes, a car is up for grabs. There are a host of other prizes as well. So go check that out. That perhaps might turn out to be the most accurate of polls, because we are actually asking people to volunteer information rather than go and try to get it out of their throats. But Amit, this entire controversy, the entire election has been fraught by this question mark over media houses and the bias and the unbiased coverage. So to say, I mean, there was a complaint in the Election Commission yesterday on the last day of polling that Narendra Modi's speech were being broadcast live, and that was across TV channels. So as far as media bias is concerned, such controversies do reflect upon, I mean, or do add to the fire over there.
In fact, as Venkatesh said, it is still not clear about the current controversy. And to the best of my knowledge, another split company with a similar name has done it, but officially there has been no statement or reinstatement of the controversy. So as far as journalists, we should be still hesitant to jump to any conclusion on this. I honestly feel that we are in a trap of a culture industry or a culture media industry, where we're constantly looking for grabbing eyeballs. Going for sensational, vicarious and cathartic conclusions, distracting ourselves from deep critical thinking, not pausing, not looking at complexities and layers, and especially when it comes to a science or a pretension of a science, which is still evolving. which is quite half-baked in terms of it, larger format in methodology and sample survey. Sample surveys are itself, even in anthropology, sample surveys are, or sociology, social sciences, sample surveys are still taken very critically. It is not taken as absolute truth. And here, the media kind of jumps into, as if it is a kind of a tendency in the last few years you have seen, which is a kind of a retarded kind of a reaction, that you jump on something and just don't want to, you know, it can be a bomb blast, or it can be a controversy, or it can be an exit poll. There's no critical layer to that thinking. And as, you know, briefly I would say, as Rahul Verma on India Post Live has said, and Yashwant Deshmukh also, this was perhaps the only place I saw where there was a kind of a rational and intelligent and enlightened discourse on the whole process of exit polls, and not, you know, everyone giving gyan and everyone trying to be one upmanship of knowing better than anybody else. Well, the best of journalists are still very, very clueless about this hard-fought elections. And I think one of the most important factors, which Rahul and others have said, two factors in fact, one is that these are reflective of a trend rather than of a final tally. Mm-hmm. And it should not be seen as a one-day game ending in a final tally. Mm-hmm. And the game is still in process. So don't reduce it into a game.
But then at the end of the day, perhaps media houses are themselves to blame for that game, because every time they seemingly get it right or close enough to the target, they say that we got it right. But I want to get in Matthew, because he's conducted such researches. And Matthew, as far as the 2014 general election is concerned, the survey agencies, the political research aspect of it has certainly been marred in terms of, we had that sting operation and now that this controversy. So the entire community of pollsters, I mean, what is the sense over there?
Well, it is unfair to give pollsters a bad name just because there were one or two sporadic incidents. But overall, let me tell you one thing. In this particular controversy, Times Now has recruited some organization called ORG India, which is actually Operations Research Guild and not Operations Research Group, which is part of the bigger AC Nielsen team. And I believe that now ORG India is a breakaway or split faction of ORG Mark AC Nielsen. And I think it is unfair to give pollsters a bad name for this particular controversy.
You can't deny the fact, Matthew, that 10 agencies were caught in a sting operation, now this controversy. I mean, at the end of the day, somebody has to be held accountable. Isn't that the case? I mean, after that sting operation, I mean, they don't come under any criminal or civil law, I mean, just in terms of just putting out content.
But then, you see, one thing is name and shame them. Second thing is media houses should not give them work. Media houses, if they think that, you know, they have been shortchanged or they have shortchanged the viewers, they should not give them work again. Why is it that people who failed successively, why are they given work again and again by the same media houses? So they move from one media house to the other. I mean, then if that is the case, then punish them. If they get it wrong, punish them.
That would be a little too harsh, perhaps, if they get it wrong, to punish them. But Amit, just the fact that it does, the media bias question has obviously crept into this election. And this latest controversy, I mean, the first question once again, is adding fuel to that fire as far as the media bias is concerned.
Yeah, for instance, there has been you have seen one person being shown live for such a long time, even before the elections were declared. You know, it was like cut and live as far as one has seen them. But you never have seen, even you don't see Fidel Castro or Nelson Mandela or you know, Mother Teresa, or even Barack Obama being shown live for as long as he speaks on any rally. It is a completely unique phenomenon which has happened in the Indian media, and live without any ad. Well, in a cricket match, even every ball or two balls you have ads. Here you did. I mean, there's no ad. God knows from where they get the ad revenue. It's a kind of this is something of media researchers should look at as to how this continuous live phenomenon happened. This was itself a form of bias, if you can say that. Secondly, there has been, obviously, as you can see, year after year, and even sophologists in their, you know, humility, especially, you know, Rahul and Yashwant, have agreed that there is always an overestimation to BJP. I mean, in the sense that the BJP as a party, of course, does more muscle flexing and chest thumping than any other party, and it expresses itself much more aggressively But the media also, you know, completely falls in line with that kind of an expression. And the exit polls continuously give overestimate the tally and underestimate others, including, you know, voices like BSP, etc. When the BSP put up the candidates 1 year ago for this Lok Sabha elections, they were perhaps the most unreported party in this 2014 elections. So between a cynicism, the exit polls are finally creating, you might grab eyeballs for a day and you can give gyan and you can rush, have adrenaline rush and people can have a catharsis, but it is creating a larger cynicism in the intelligent civil society about the validity of exit polls.
All right, Matthew, the fact is that, leave aside exit polls, just the fact that a lot of data crunching started happening a year ago as far as this election, a lot of permutation combinations. I mean, we had election programming starting from way back in 2013 for this general election. But at the end of the day, I mean, the big question mark over the methodology being used, and none of these media houses really ever share the methodology that is often used. Doesn't that leave a viewer wanting, and perhaps a very pertinent question for a viewer to ask anytime somebody says that we've conducted the most accurate exit poll?
Transparency when it comes to either opinion polls or exit polls or post polls. Transparency is one ingredient which is missing in all these surveys. And
we seem to have lost that link with Matthew. We'll just get back to that. But Venkesh, to
put
on
the same question to you. One aspect that Amit pointed out to, I mean, I want to stress that this present controversy that has come up today, even that has highlighted a different kind of muddle that exists in this whole thing. See, immediately after this story broke, immediately after this story that ORG has, you know, denied that they have done the survey, the kind of grapevine, the kind of...
In fact, I'll just ask my producer to play out that grapevine for you, because we had a couple of tweets that were doing the rounds by very senior editors of their respective networks talking about the same.
Yeah, not only that. I mean, in fact, I think the tweets perhaps were respectable. I mean, what was being circulated in the media space was that, you know, that Arnab Goswami, who is the editor-in-chief of Times Now, has been given a two-week notice to leave. I mean, this kind of thing was being circulated in the media space. So, you know, there is a kind of scavenger attitude that has come into this whole business. And I think that is, you know, even more sorry than the situation that the pollsters are creating.
All right, we're also being joined. We're joined very soon by image guru Dilip Cherian, who will be joining us.
I'm online.
Yes, you're there, Dilip. So we're just trying to get your picture as well. Meanwhile, we've been talking about the exit polls, and I believe you had a word with the respective organizations who've been involved in this controversy. So we'd just like to get a perspective from you as far as this entire controversy about the fake exit poll goes.
You know, essentially, it's a quarrel between two organizations which were created from the split of the main ORG. Mm-hmm. So I think the real reason why there was so much anxiety was because ORG, which held the original brand name, and ORG India, which was a result of a split, which Amit Roy heads, had issues about the fact that ORG India was given the mandate by Arnab to do this. And anyone who knows the Bennett Coleman group knows that it is a huge exercise to get anyone to get a contract which involves payment outwards from the Bennett Coleman group. Payments inwards are quite easy, but payments outward requires a whole bunch of signatures. So it was clearly vetted by many levels, and I think what has annoyed Arnab is the speed at which many people who were interested, for whatever reason, to play this up as a controversy, decided to make it a big media issue.
All right, fair enough, but it has become a media issue given the fact that, I mean, people use social media for their benefit, and sometimes social media does not go according to the plan, and that is what is perhaps happening over here. Because as far as the grapevine is concerned, as Venkatesh was pointing out, the grapevine was completely a buzz with this controversy. Dilip, but the entire question over exit polls, these opinion polls, the methodology, is it something that perhaps 2014 has, because we've had it for the past, I think, 3 or 4 general elections, the exits and the opinion polls, but the entire methodology behind them, that has certainly come into question given the fact that we had a sting operation and now this kind of a controversy.
the thing that most people are forgetting is one fundamental aspect. Opinion polls will only give you the percentages of votes per party. In Britain, which has been doing opinion polls for a much longer time than we have, what Mori, which is the most respected opinion pollster in the United Kingdom, does is that he gives you the vote percentages for the Tories and the Labour and the Liberals, and he does not comment on the number of seats that will generate. Here, the pressure is from media organizations searching for TRPs to try and get them to do the conversion from vote percentages into seats. And, you know, what Mori does to take care of the same pressure which exists everywhere else is that they give only vote percentages, but on a blank piece of paper with no Mori letterhead, they give each media house an estimate of what the likely seats are likely to translate into. So the seat translation has to bear the imprint of the media house which is seeking to use Mori's percentage figures or somebody else's percentage figures. But because Mori has set the benchmark that we will not give translation into seats, and that is where this whole methodology thing comes in, what needs to be accurately measured is which party got what percentage of votes in the exit poll.
All right, Matthew, I want to bring you in as far as the methodology is concerned. Dilip raising very valid points over there. To say that, to get it absolutely to the T in terms of number of seats, exactly, it's not really possible, and that is what internationally has been happening. But as far as standardization in India goes, I don't think that's been established, has it? And I think that's leading to a lot of problems.
See, there is a standard form anyway which is available online. Lokniti and CSDS are perhaps one of the most transparent organizations when it comes to this. They put up the entire, the questionnaire is available online, the methodology is available online. So most other agencies don't do that. So to that extent, you're probably right. You know, transparency and integrity are the cornerstone of this business, you know. So to that extent, yes, they should have put up the methodology. And see, the biggest thing I want to say about these exit polls is, when the results are anyway going to come out on May 16th, why do we want to give these experts and cephalologists, why do we want to preoccupy them with, coming up with this exit poll and keeping them occupied? You know, this exit poll is only to keep your experts and cephalologists occupied till May 16th. Why can't we just wait till May 16th and the real results will come out?
All right, so the impatience of the audience, eyeballs, what would you attribute it to, Venkatesh?
That's the market, plain and simple. I mean, when the market gets into play, if you want to get the eyeballs, the TRPs, you need to have gimmicks like this.
Yeah, but then doesn't that beg the question that, I mean, where is the independence, or where is the idea of an organization saying this is what we stand for, this is what we believe in, this is how we do our journalism? I mean, it becomes being part of a herd, doesn't it?
You see, there's a contradiction here. As he says, scavenger. When you're trying to, you just you get a pack of wolves, you just wait for, and you get a vulnerable victim, you go for scavengers. But you're also a herd mentality. Mm-hmm. Well, you will do exactly what the others are doing in any circumstances or on any issue. And you will not restrain yourself on a question of sensitivity or intelligence or a critical pause to get to the truth. But you will jump into the thing with a herd mentality also, and while you're doing scavenging. This is typical of a kind of a backward capitalist scenario, which India is witnessing, and which, as Dilip Cherian so rightly says, is not happening in the United Kingdom. There's a sanctity of that kind of a poll. And second is, this market is is not a abstract entity. The market is also predator. It is market is also looking at the world as a homogeneity. The world is not a homogeneity. The media, what the media does in terms of a corporate backed media does, is underestimate the intelligence of the reader or the intelligence of the viewer. Well, if the viewer can be patient to witness and go through the election process for 1.5 months or 2 months, surely the viewer can also wait for another 3 days, and the viewer, you can give the intelligence of the if you want to test the intelligence audience or the viewer, maybe you can show documentaries or short films or short ground reporting.
Or ask the viewer to participate as we are asking the viewer to participate.
Or the viewers can participate and you show them the ground reality of you know, do some good reporting from the ground and show this is the way this constituency has reacted. Post polls also, there can be so much of good reporting from the ground. Why jump on this kind of a both herd mentality and scavenger kind of a syndrome?
All right, Dilip, I, as far as the market goes, I mean, that's the conventional argument that is given. That is what I think Venkatesh also said, that it's the market determining the kind of content that is being produced and therefore you have exit polls. But I mean, hasn't this market become too much of a herd, and is it too convenient an excuse for not applying yourself or not doing something well?
You know, I think that the market is partially to blame, but also the other part is that lazy journalism. You know, essentially what's happened over the years is that unless you run opinion polls over a period of several months or quarters, you will not actually get a trend of what's going on. And you know, it might be music to pollsters' ears, but the fact is that media houses are still not willing to spend the money to do it early enough to be able to get to seats. Meaning, as soon as these elections are over, remember that you're going to have elections in Maharashtra. Now, Maharashtra requires to be studied now, post these elections, and then all the way up to elections. That's how you will get pollsters giving you some idea of what's going to happen in the state elections in Maharashtra. But media companies will now go to sleep and wait for the week before elections or the week before election announcement to start getting excited about it.
All right, fair enough. So the media houses themselves are to blame. But I mean, these polls are critical. You take the American system, for example, and over there, just on the basis of that opinion, a candidate's candidature for even the presidency gets determined and they have to bow out if the opinion polls are not in their favor. So are we ever going to get to that stage where they can be that, can be taken as the truth?
No, I suppose it may be cynical to say that we will never reach that stage. Mm. But I think we are far, far long way off, actually.
And why would you say that?
Because if you look at the society, if you look at the kind of imbalances that we have, look at the kind of political system, that even the electoral system that we have. Mm-hmm. Even in this election, somebody like Narendra Modi, who is supposedly riding a huge popular wave, he has been saying that the election commission is not fair, they have allowed rigging in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. And others have also been accusing the same thing about the BJP and various parties. And Rahul Gandhi, you know, going to his own constituency on the day of the elections and telling people going to the polling booth. So, you know, I think to imagine that, you know, that we will be in a place like that, where opinion polls also become part of a proper democratic exercise, I think it may happen, but then it's not going to happen in the near future.
All right, I'll just ask my producers to play out those tweets that have been doing the rounds as far as the media organizations are concerned. And you can see that popular TV channel hosts are certainly indulging in a war on Twitter. They're not taking names, but then the name calling or the slandering certainly is there. I mean, slander, I don't know, but a question mark certainly being raised over there. But Amit, this is the same question that I put to Venkatesh. As far as the American system goes, it's really defined, the entire poll process is defined by these opinion polls and opinion polls. How far are we from that stage? And is it a good model to follow? Should we try to achieve that model?
Well, I think we had a very peculiar case of an opinion poll in the middle of the elections, because opinion polls are not allowed, and it was kind of a given opinion poll, which is the exit poll camouflaged as an opinion poll, actually. While phases were still going on, people were going to vote, which was completely, where 272 was given to BJP. And secondly, there is a widespread opinion that there was a mythical, it was a manufactured consent, to be used Noam Chomsky kind of a category. There was a manufacturing consent and a mythical wave which was created. A lot of reporters on the ground did not find any wave on the ground. They actually found an anti-Congress wave very strongly, which Mr. Modi is riding, and which all intelligent observers are actually stating. But there was no wave. The wave was completely a media-created wave. So much so, not only the media, not only Mr. Modi, the media itself started believing that he has already become the Prime Minister. So much so, there is a joke that since for the last 6 months he's already become the prime minister, there's already an anti-incumbency against Modi. But in terms of lazy journalism, as Dilip Chetan says, it's right that we are witness to lazy journalism. Like, for instance, how much do we know about Vidarbha, for instance? It's a huge area, and the thousands of farmers who have committed suicide. There's a debate on Monsanto. It's a debate. It's a living debate. You can support it or you need not support it. But there's debate. There's a water crisis there, and there's a huge crisis. There are widows who are they're debt-ridden farmers. There's suicides. Well, it's not a question of showing tragedy. It's a journalist's job to show these constituencies what the representatives of the people are giving to these constituencies. So we are constantly in a kind of a circle of unreason, whereby we underestimate the intelligence or the sensitivity of the leader, and we try to give them package deals. And which is a kind of a catharsis, a continuous anti-catharsis, which is a vicarious thing, continuous, which goes on. It's like a page three kind of a thing, actually.
Huh? All right, so has that what our news content has been reduced to, Dilip Charian?
Yes, I would say that I agree with that viewpoint, that there has been a sad reduction in the quality of analysis, of looking at the big issues. And I think that alongside media, the lot we are not blaming is the consumer. I hope that the consumer starts, the viewer, the consumer of news starts to participate more in organizations like India Post Live and actually give their view, so that you can cut out a lot of the middlemen in this whole business and you hear real voices from the ground, unedited all the time.
Absolutely. In fact, I just like to remind all of viewers that if you want to participate, your voice will for sure be heard over here. You can use social media. Go to Facebook. There's a Facebook page of India Post Live that you can post a comment on. Use Twitter, hashtag India Post Live to your tweets, or use our Twitter handle at India Post Live, or hashtag Hum Bole, because on India Post Live, there's a Hum Bole contest where you can predict the winner of the 2014 general election, and whether who wins or not, you can certainly win that day because you can get a big sedan car for yourselves. Yes, that's the contest that are on your screens right now, and there are a host of other prizes as well. So I'll just also quickly read out a couple of tweets that have come in. In fact, Anil Kohli writes in, point is not the bogus firm, issue is that particular media house using it and presenting it to viewers without verifying the antecedents of the company. And that final comments, gentlemen, that I think the media is to blame for, just the fact that we want to push things through that far, that we want to be the first on everything and make as much of an impression as we can, that often things go awry.
No, I think as far as a specific case is concerned, I think checking the antecedents of the company is not an issue which we can raise against Times Now.
Yeah.
I don't think that's an issue at all. But then the larger culture exists, as we have discussed over the last few minutes. The larger culture exists that where there is lazy journalism, there is this herd mentality, there is also this scavenger mentality, and there is ultimately the market.
Right.
So, I think these things have to be understood and kind of analyzed in a comprehensive manner, in its totality, and only then we can go forward. And as Dilip very rightly pointed out, participatory media experiments and participatory media exercises need to be strengthened.
All right, so no sermonizing over here. You can come and sermonize if you want, and we'll wrap up on that. So we're looking forward to what you, the viewer, have to say. Thanks very much, Dilip, for coming in, Amit and Venkatesh for joining me in the studio. Well, that's it on this conversation, but the exit polls, the question marks about media, whatever you have to say, come participate, come talk to us. We are here to listen to you. On that note, thanks so much for watching.